Welcome to the future. PBS Digital.
It's the deepest crack in the Earth's crust. The river made it, but humans reshape it. It harbors the spirits of ancestors, the garbage of idiots, and the power to light up Vegas. It's not just another pretty view. Join us now as we explore the layers of conflict within the Grand Canyon, a Naked Planet special. This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Desert Southwest lies one of the world's most amazing marvels. It's over a mile from top to bottom. It's hundreds of miles long, but you wouldn't even know it was there until you were right on top of it. The Grand Canyon.
If there's anything the Grand Canyon gives you a sense of, it's a sense of space.
It's just something, it's what we like to call in the business is canyon magic.
And many people come to the Grand Canyon and they look at the wonderful geology, and it is a wonderful textbook for geology, but it's also a wonderful textbook for human history.
The Grand Canyon is our relative, our grandmother Earth, and our ancestors are still here. The spirits of our ancestors are still here.
Recently, I came across this really wonderful quote by a great Grand Canyon geologist of the last century. His name is Clarence Dutton. And Dutton wrote, "The mention at Grand Canyon means nothing to the senses, and all we are left with is a troubled sense of immensity." And I like that idea, a troubled sense of immensity. At times, I feel very special at the Grand Canyon, and mostly I feel very insignificant. And it makes me ponder, what is my place on this planet Earth? And I have a feeling that I'm never going to figure it out.
The Grand Canyon is the most famous natural wonder on the face of the planet. In places, it's 18 miles across and up to a mile deep. It snakes its way between Lake Mead in the west and Lake Powell to the east, a 277-mile-long open wound carved deep into the Earth's crust. For scientists, a journey into its depths is a rare chance to peer back into the early history of the planet. For most of us, it's simply the size of the canyon that makes it an irresistible place of pilgrimage. But one response to these feelings has been man's urge to control and dominate the canyon and its river. Since it was first invaded during the days of the Wild West, its waters have been dammed, its walls blasted away, and its depths flooded in the name of progress. Yet the more we learn about the canyon, the more it seems that whatever we do to change it, the canyon may yet be too big to be tamed.
And the obvious question is, why do people feel the urge and the necessity to come to the Grand Canyon? They've seen pictures. They've heard about it. Why do they want to come here? And I guess the simple answer is there is no other scenic spectacle like it on the earth. There is no other canyon that even comes close to what the Grand Canyon is all about.
In 1903, champion of the great outdoors, President Theodore Roosevelt declared the Grand Canyon a great sight that every American should see. From that moment on, the canyon's fate as a tourist destination was sealed.
The Grand Canyon is in the western part of the United States, in the state of Arizona. You can easily find it if you look for the Colorado River, which begins up here in northern Colorado, runs down through Utah and Arizona to the Mexican border and finally into the Gulf of California. Grand, of course, refers to the fact that it is a very big canyon. And canyon is defined as a deep valley.
5 million people visit each year, and for the vast majority, the encounter centers on the south rim, from where everyone takes pictures. However crowded, the experience still leaves an indelible impression on all who confront it.
Well, I feel that connection with God because I could see the majesty of this unbelievable sight. And you can just wonder, what else is there? And the other planets and the stars. And
it's a step to the universe. A greater being. Yeah.
Something that the indigenous peoples who've lived here for thousands of years learnt many centuries ago. The Hualapai Indians are just one of several Native American groups who believe that their ancestors were created here. This is Spirit Mountain, to the southwest of the main canyon. To the Hualapai, it's the place where the world began.
Spirit Mountain is the place of our creation. The Grand Canyon is a part of the territory there within this area. And the canyons, that's why it's so significant to us, because this is where our Creator sent us to live. And He gave us the water, He gave us the plants, and He gave us the animals to survive off of. He taught us this, and He taught us to be good. And it's a lot like what the Bible says. That's why Spirit Mountain is so important.
These markings carved into the rock are literally the Hualapai's history written in stone. They tell of a flood that covered the world and how the Creator sent word to dig a huge hole to drain the land, and how, as the waters receded, they left behind Hayatarta, the backbone of the world. The Grand Canyon.
This history is real to us, and this is our history through the rocks, and this is what the writings are about. They usually tell us, you know, where the springs are, what the landscape is like, the dangers and trails, and where the canyons are, and if it's going to be a difficult travel or not.
The Hualapai's creation story has echoes in the scientific version of events. The formation of something as large and spectacular as the canyon was the result of powerful and violent events involving fire and flood. Combined forces which over millions of years have peeled back and exposed these bands of colored rock, rocks that not only give the canyon its unique appearance, but reveal vital clues as to how it was formed.
One of the real keys to appreciate the Grand Canyon is the variety of rock, the variety of strata that we see here. If you look out here, even without knowing the names of rocks, you can see the bottom of the Grand Canyon is very distinctive. We call it the inner gorge. It's made out of a couple of types of rocks we call igneous and metamorphic. And then if you'll notice the upper part of the Grand Canyon, the upper three quarters, very, very distinctly layered.
The nine bands of rock that make up the top layers of the Central Canyon are limestone and sandstone, laid down between 250 and 850 million years ago. At the canyon's deepest, within its inner gorge, lie rocks which are evidence of a totally different world, so ancient that life, even in its most primitive form, had not yet begun to evolve. These rocks are the remains of a once huge volcanic mountain range formed 1.8 billion years ago.
If you really want to simply state why this canyon is so very special to the planet Earth, from the very bottom of the Grand Canyon to the very top, we have here in one vertical mile just about every type of rock you could possibly imagine. It doesn't get any better than this.
How these rocks came to be exposed is the result of two incredible feats of geology which formed the canyon. The Grand Canyon lays within the Colorado Plateau. Once the bed of an ancient sea, this entire area is now 7,000 feet above sea level.
How do you get a bunch of rock at 7,000 feet? Particularly rock that was formed in a warm water sea environment.
It's due to an extraordinary event known as uplift.
When we're talking about the uplifting of a continent, we're talking about the entire Colorado Plateau.
The powerful forces of uplift occur when one continental plate meets another. One of them has to give and is forced downward into molten magma below the Earth's crust, where the solid rock is melted. This cooking deep in the Earth creates intense pressure beneath the surface plate, forcing it upwards.
So you have an uplifting of this entire Colorado Plateau feature area. And as it uplifts, it happens over a long, slow period of time. And it uplifts that rock from sea level to over 7,000 feet. And in some areas, when we're talking about Colorado Rockies, we're talking about it uplifting over 12,000 feet.
Over a period of 5 million years, as the plateau lifted, the Colorado River, working under gravity and trying to find sea level, worked against it, slicing down through successive layers of rock. As a result, though uplift has provided the elevation, it's the river that has gouged out the canyon. The erosive power of the Colorado River is second to none. It's fed by a vast catchment area, including melting snows from the immense Rocky Mountains. Its side canyons, which lead into the main valley, add to this by periodically funneling even more floodwater into the canyon. During high flood, the waters have been known to move giant boulders the size of a car. The river's raw power tore so violently into the Colorado Plateau after it rose up out of the sea that it cut the canyon out in 5 million years, virtually overnight in geological terms. As the Grand Canyon was carved, the powerful dynamics of both river and rock uniquely combined to affect every aspect of life here. At the heart of a remote side canyon deep within the southwestern stretch of the Grand Canyon is Matwita. It's a natural spring settled by the ancestors of the Wallapai 600 years ago. The Hualapai have always fiercely protected their sacred lands in the canyon from outsiders. Now they are being visited by a scientist who spent his life trying to understand the influence of the Grand Canyon on the evolution of life here. For paleontologist Jim Mead, this investigation is made possible by the unique way in which caves preserve the remains of ancient, long extinct animals. Caves owe their existence to the erosive power of the Colorado River. They make the canyon a laboratory that contains an extraordinary story about the exotic animals that once roamed here.
As water percolated through the limestone and dolomite, when the river was much higher than this, than what we see today, that water etched out the caves. These are now available to be lived in by the ringtail cat, the pack rat, the mountain goat, the ground sloth, or people.
No one has precisely counted all the thousands of caves in the Grand Canyon region. Jim Mead has investigated many of them, but here on the Hualapai Reservation, he is seeing caves few people have ever visited. For the Hualapai, caves are burial sites and must be treated with respect.
Ah, so this is the cave. Come here. How are you?
Jim Mead is as likely to find human remains here as those of animals.
This is a fantastic place. You can see on the floor back in here areas that obviously not only people but say bighorn sheep and other animals have lived.
The inner canyon is extremely dry, and these dry conditions in the caves result in the extraordinary preservation of organic remains stretching back thousands of years.
This is a warehouse of information that I see both from the present day ecosystem and from the Ice Age. Each one is definitely a museum. This is a skull of a California condor. What makes it very unique, if you can, is the dry preservation. You can see that here's the eye, here where my thumb is, and the beak. And what's really unusual is the fact that we have the keratin beak here at the end. This is the material that usually erodes away. And this specimen is 14,000 years old.
Remains like these are not fossils where living tissue has been turned to stone, but actual bone, preserved unaltered since the last ice age. Other extraordinary remains allow me to reconstruct the ancient environment. This dried out dung is 11,000 years old. It's full of grass and other plant remains, which prove that the creature that left it here grazed in an environment cool and wet enough to sustain grassy savanna-like conditions. The extinct American mammoth.
It's an unusual remain. This one dates about 11,600 years old. And it's unusual in that we have over 300 cubic meters of this mammoth dung. Looks like it was laid yesterday. And actually, if you were to moisten this down, you would say a few other things about how fresh it is, too. Totally desiccated, totally dried it out. Well, thank you for showing me.
Jim Mead's discoveries reveal that the climate here must have been very different to support a range of extinct animals.
Now, I would have fully expected 11, 12,000 years ago to see mammoth, herds of mammoth, herds of horses and camels up there. It wouldn't have looked like the Serengeti Plain, but it would have definitely been quite different than what we see today.
Mead's work also indicates that the end of the last ice age saw a sharp change in climate. An increase in temperature killed off the vegetation on which the mammoth depended, so driving them out. But one species, more adaptable than most, survived and proliferated. Man. Archaeological discoveries show a magnificent culture once flourished here, a prehistoric culture that reached a level of sophistication greater than anywhere else in North America, but mysteriously disappeared. The Grand Canyon is an environment of climatic extremes. From scorched canyon floor to the rim, a mile above, There's as much climatic variation as you'd find on a 1,000-mile journey from the deserts of California to the snowy mountains of southern Canada. And it's this that made the canyon the place where Native Americans flourished. The Hualapai can be traced back 600 years. Their songs and prayers appease the spirits of their ancestors and the land itself. But they were not the first native peoples to live here. The canyon lands have seen ancient cultures grow, flourish, and mysteriously disappear. Evidence of this culture much older than the Hualapai is being uncovered by archaeologist Jan Balsam within the Grand Canyon National Park.
We have recorded somewhere around 3,700 archaeological sites in the park. We estimate that there's somewhere around 50,000 sites in the park, so we have our work cut out for us. We have a lot to do.
This rubble is all that remains of a pueblo, a prehistoric Native American settlement, which dates to a time before Europeans came.
We are literally a stone's throw away from the state highway that runs along the east rim of Grand Canyon National Park. And this is a prehistoric pueblo that was occupied somewhere around 1,000 years ago by the ancestral Puebloan people. Some folks know them as the Anasazi.
At the height of their occupation, the Anasazi ranged throughout the canyon. The nearby ruined pueblo of Mesa Verde was begun 1,200 years ago, proof of a culture whose architecture displays a sophistication unequaled anywhere else in prehistoric North America. The Anasazi were also among the earliest in North America to adopt agriculture, using maize, beans, and squash crops developed by the Great Pyramid Builders of Mexico. The unique environmental characteristics of the Grand Canyon help them to do this.
You know, the way people use the canyon is totally tied to the formation of the canyon itself. When you look at the way the rims are and how people are using it down into the river, there is a definite correlation between how people were living and the canyon itself. I mean, they really, in a lot of ways, became one with the canyon, knowing exactly when to move, how to move, and we're totally in sync with the environment and the geology and the plant life and the animal life. The folks who were living here were very, very successful.
But being farmers didn't mean ancient Indians were tied to one place. Making use of climatic variations also led to a nomadic existence. In winter, they stayed deep within the canyon, which provided warmth and protection. Fertile soils brought by seasonal floods on the Colorado River made shorelines ideal for growing crops. In the summer, the top rim of the canyon provided relief from the inferno of the inner gorge. The land itself has always been in control here, but play by the rules and the canyon can be very bountiful.
You're almost 5,000 feet in elevation, and plants become available at different times of the year. The animals use different elevational levels as you go down to the river and back up again. So folks really did have a pretty good grocery store, really.
Just how prosperous prehistoric occupiers were is hinted at by the range and quantity of artifacts found within archaeological sites connected to the canyon.
Well, let's see. We've got quite a little assortment of artifacts here. Everything from pieces of pottery to pieces of chipstone that would have been used to make projectile points or arrowheads, scrapers, knives, all sorts of things like that. There's a small piece of decorated pottery. There's not enough of the design here to see, but there's a some small black lines on top of a white slip. This would have been the inside of a bowl, it looks like. Probably it was made around 1050 AD. A lot of the corrugated pieces, folks would be making pottery, and they'd be rolling out clay in their hands, and then they'd sort of build it from a base up. And one of the neat things about these is that you can still see the fingernail impressions, where they'd roll the clay out and build their pots. They were very good potters. I mean, you're looking at things that are 1,000 years old.
But around 800 years ago, the Anasazi suddenly disappeared from the canyon. The exact reasons are still a mystery. The arrival of competing tribes and even cannibalism have been claimed as contributing factors. But what is certain is that a significant change in climate happened at that time. Evidence suggests that temperatures soared, the desert expanded, and crops withered, driving the Anasazi away, just as it had the mammoths 10,000 years before them. After the Anasazi disappeared, roaming bands of hunters moved in. But when Europeans eventually confronted the canyon, it was seen as nothing but an obstacle to their progress.
We have other figures in our history that have looked at this as an utterly profitless place, believing that they would be the first and the last to see any profit from this place and to ever visit here. Yet we go back again and look at the prehistoric record, and we know that people were living here for maybe as many as 10,000 years. They didn't see this as a barrier.
In 1540, Spanish conquistadors moving up from Mexico spent a week attempting to find a crossing point and gave up in despair. For them, this hole in the earth was too vast, the landscape too baffling. For hundreds of years after, the place that's now a Mecca for tourists was avoided completely. By the mid-1800s, the Grand Canyon was still one of the last uncharted regions in the entire United States. But with westward expansion, the race to map and survey the region at last opened up the canyon. In 1869, a one-armed Civil War veteran named John Wesley Powell became the first person to lead an expedition through the canyon by boat. Powell's three-month journey into the unknown took the lives of three men, but in doing so, placed the Grand Canyon into the hearts and minds of America. By the beginning of the 20th century, in the wake of Roosevelt's endorsement, the invasion of the canyon was well advanced. The Grand Canyon changed forever. This is Lee's Ferry. Located at the eastern upstream end of the canyon, it's the only place along its entire length where the river is directly accessible. In the days of the Wild West, it became a ferry point. A settlement grew up here, and the remains of this outpost are still visible, abandoned since the 1920s. Today, Lee's Ferry has been reborn because of a challenge that has thrilled people since the days of John Wesley Powell: running the mighty rapids of the Colorado. Commercial river running began in the early 50s. Trips were undertaken during periods of high floodwaters, making river running a high-risk thrill ride. Confronting the might of the Colorado had a powerful impact on all who took part. River runners like Stacy Woodard are the latest in a proud tradition.
My roots are down here. My third great grandfather is John D. Lee, who was named after this place that we're at right now.
The passage of time has done nothing to lessen the impact the experience has on the present day generation.
This is my life. I dream about it in the wintertime, the off season. And you can talk to every boatman on this beach right now, and I can pretty much guarantee it that they would say the same thing. Some people say that the Grand Canyon, the Colorado River, has changed their lives, and And that's very, very rewarding for me to hear that. Conquer the Colorado. The Colorado River is in charge. Well, every once in a while, it'll give you a break now and then. But if you try to beat the Colorado River, it's futile.
Rather than a view from the rim a mile above, many prefer to see the canyon close up. For them, river running is the ultimate way to experience it.
Good to see you. Wish she's coming with
us. You're gonna let me go.
When he was young, Larry Sanderson was among the first to mount expeditions, and to this day finds the draw of the river a powerful one.
I hate to see these boats leave without me on them. When you're down there in the canyon, you see the river, the canyon walls, and everything else is just gone. You just have a complete isolation, and there's the beauty. Things that are so dear to you in the outside world, completely gone from you, and you just be engrossed in that canyon.
River running the Colorado is now big business, experienced by over 25,000 people a year.
Have a great trip.
Thanks, Larry.
It has turned experiencing the Grand Canyon into a fully interactive sport. But the Grand Canyon is no theme park. The ecology of the canyon, always a fine and delicate balance, is only made all the more precarious by human intrusion. Many creatures have suffered as a direct result of the invasion of the canyon. And here at the Vermilion Cliffs, just 2 miles downstream of Lee's Ferry, one species more than any other has been brought to the brink of extinction. Californian condor sailed the thermals above the Grand Canyon centuries before any human set foot in it. For at least 40,000 years, it adapted to climatic upheavals and survived the Ice Age. Then the white man came, and within the space of 80 years, it had been hunted almost to extinction. By 1982, only 22 birds remained. Facing total annihilation, they were all captured and placed in protective custody. Only time would tell if they would survive. The condor was reintroduced into the canyon in 1996. It's too early to tell if their future is assured. Sean Ferry is the field leader of the Condor Recovery Program. He's responsible for nurturing the birds through the critical first few years of adjustment.
It's a pretty unique opportunity that we can so quickly, you know, kind of try and counteract something that was ultimately, you know, man's fault, if you will. We're looking for a remote area, since most of their problems were related to humans. So they all here?
Yeah, we've got 8 up here at the carcass.
Condors grow up slowly. It takes them 5 years to reach maturity. They need space and seclusion, and the canyon plays a crucial role. Searching for food, the birds use the canyon as an aerial highway. Riding the strong thermals, they execute round trips of anything up to 600 miles in less than 4 days. Tagged with radio transmitters before their release, monitoring the birds' movements is a daily ritual. Even so, it's rare to see them up close, and rarer still to find these solitary birds in large numbers. But Ferry and colleague Kirsty Bly are lucky. A fresh carcass is a powerful draw for a species that does not itself hunt to eat.
They're strictly scavengers. They're carrion feeders. They don't feed on anything unless it's dead. And they're a social bird. They work together. It benefits the individual to work as a group. You know, one bird finds a carcass 10 miles away and circles over it in classic vulture fashion. The rest of them key in on that behavior and all go over and feed.
14's still there, though.
Whoever that other unknown bird is, maybe 27, because there's no other transmitter coming from this location. We keep very close tabs on the birds. They're all still very young. And there's only about 150 in the world, so each bird is extremely valuable. So we monitor them as closely as possible. Our goal is to have a self-sufficient population out here. We don't want to be feeding them. My goal is to have birds out here without wing tags and without transmitters on them, just being condors, breeding in the canyon, doing what they do. And that's our ultimate goal. We don't want to have a free-flying zoo out here. We want condors and wild condors.
The story of the condor shows how damaging the impact of people can be. But the use of the Grand Canyon as more than a place to simply relax and enjoy has had the farthest-reaching implications for its future. This is a landscape created by the raw power of water, and that power is now being harnessed by tens of millions of people. Las Vegas is one of the entertainment capitals of the country. Here, everything fake is fun. They've even built a plastic canyon. Most visitors remain unaware of the huge influence the real Grand Canyon has on the survival of Las Vegas. The energy to light every neon sign is derived directly from the waters of the Colorado River as they pour through the canyon. Without the power supplied by the Grand Canyon, Vegas would be a ghost town in the desert. Not only Las Vegas, but other towns in the region owe their presence to the canyon. Lying at its eastern end, 40 years ago, the town of Page didn't exist. One of the driest environments on the face of the planet, it is not a place you would immediately associate with well-manicured golf greens. But they're here. Today, technology means man can impose himself and his pursuits on the landscape, even building golf courses in the desert. Page and its golf course, just like Las Vegas and its lights, exist because of the Glen Canyon Dam. 10 million tons of poured concrete, pinned into 700-foot sandstone cliffs. The Glen Canyon Dam near Page was completed in 1963 and generates enough power to supply millions of city dwellers. It's a staggering feat of engineering, and during the lean 1950s, provided Larry Sanderson with a living. From river running, he turned to high scaling.
High scalers, a special breed of men, are needed for the canyon conquest. Men who swing nonchalantly from their lines to trim the high cliffs by hand. Prying here, probing there, sending loose slabs of rock tumbling down, making certain the concrete structure man will build will truly and precisely fit into tailored rock walls.
Go over the canyon wall the first time. If you go down here and try and look over the side, it's a little spooky. The second time I was able to go over and maybe look down a little bit, but that first time, it gets you. I was in three rock slides. One time was tons of rock came over me and I had swung inside of a tunnel to keep from getting hit and untied off of the rope. We had three high scalers that were killed. So it is a danger. You only make one mistake, high scale it.
After years of survey work and preparation, one of the proudest moments in Sanderson's life came with his part in the dedication ceremony to mark the start of the dam's construction.
Right over there was where we had to blast the first blast for the dedication for Eisenhower to punch the button in Washington, and then the plunger man pushed the button. Oh, it was a great moment. You should have seen, it filled this whole canyon with dust as it went off. They wanted a lot of noise and a lot of dust, and we sure did that.
The dam took 10 years to complete. As a high scaler for almost 35 years, Larry Sanderson owes his livelihood to the Glen Canyon Dam. For him and thousands like him, it has brought nothing but good.
When we first came out here, there was nothing, just the sheer canyon walls. And then after we built the dam and the lake started backing up, it made a complete change from a barren desert area to an area where recreation is so great. And so many people can come and enjoy it now, where before there wasn't even any roads here. Nobody could ever come out here and see the great beauty that we have.
Because the dam means the flow of the mighty Colorado River is controllable, today massive flash floods are a thing of the past, allowing river running nearly all year round. But constructing the Glen Canyon Dam has done more than tame a wilderness. Build any dam and you create a lake, and the one behind Glen Canyon Dam is vast. This is Lake Powell. A 186-mile long reservoir providing water to millions of homes and providing one of North America's premier boating marinas. But its waters hide a secret sacrificed in the name of progress. Under the waters of Lake Powell lies the old canyon. Inserting the dam, like a 300-foot thick concrete plug, has had the effect of drowning this immense section of canyon, creating in its place a 600-foot deep reservoir with a shoreline almost 2,000 miles long. It's a playground that brings pleasure to millions, but there are those to whom constructing the dam has come at a heavy price. A few sections of Glen Canyon survived the drowning, though the vast majority was lost beneath the lake. These sandstones are the compacted remains of ancient desert dunes, carved and shaped by hundreds of thousands of years of flash floods. Back in the 1950s, Hollywood starlet Katie Lee spent years exploring them. To her and her close friends, this was paradise.
I hiked in here maybe 25, almost 30 years ago for the first time, and I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I didn't think that there was a place on Earth like this. Just a big slice out of the world. And so narrow as to be unreal.
Deep, narrow slot canyons are formed by water rapidly eroding back deep cracks within the sandstone and were especially dramatic within Glen Canyon.
I got an affinity with those particular kinds of canyons. I liked them a lot better than the wide open ones. They feel more intimate, and they feel more mysterious, and they feel more like I'm down in the womb of Mother Earth. But you know, what's happened is that I can't be in these canyons anymore. Nice place. I actually saw the water coming up when they actually flooded that place. It just broke my heart. There's no words for what I went through with that.
Once the dam was in place, it took just 17 years to drown a canyon that took 5 million to form. The landscape has changed beyond recognition.
To me, it's just one of the great, great blunders of humankind to take this incredible spot and trash it.
Today, Katie Lee belongs to a pressure group who campaigned for the draining of Lake Powell, her favorite canyon, now a gigantic boating marina.
When people look at that thing and they think it is absolutely gorgeous, I just wish it that somebody would, that they could have some idea of what they're racing over in these stupid little jet skis. There's noise. There's nothing to compare with what it used to be like. You can feel the anger in water behind it. Those ugly, ugly pieces of cement that we put there.
But nature has already bitten back. Like the canyon they flooded, Lake Powell and its dam may not last forever. In 1983, above average volumes of meltwater from the Rockies tested the Glen Canyon Dam to its limit. Desperately attempting to relieve pressure and rapidly rising water levels, every available overflow was opened. A volume of water equivalent to the amount required to meet the annual needs of nearly 5 million individuals was forced through the tunnels in just 2 months. As it did so, first concrete, then underlying sandstone were spat into the canyon below. By the time the flood had subsided, the Colorado River had gouged these huge holes into the spillway walls. The dam had come close to being overrun. To this day, the dam is waging a war with the forces of nature. Sandstone, the very rock within which it sits, is by nature porous. Today, water constantly pours into access tunnels deep within the bowels of the dam. Along the exterior cliff walls, it exploits any weaknesses within the rock. Slowly, the irresistible force of the river is finding its way through, and it's a process that's nothing new. Geological research shows that the Grand Canyon has always been subject to violent upheavals. Perhaps sooner or later, the Colorado may one day sweep away the Glen Canyon Dam. How do we know? Because it's done something like this before. Geologist Ivo Lukita considers that here at Taraweep on the Grand Canyon's north rim is the best evidence yet that in the past, amazingly violent events shaped the canyon's future, in relation to which mankind's impact is nothing. Compared to the forces that the violent earth has thrown up at Taraweep, anything humans can build is comic by comparison, if you see things from Ivo Lukita's perspective.
That white thing that you see down there on the river is a lava falls rapid, which is the biggest and most fearsome rapid on the entire Grand Canyon. And it is really quite remarkable that where you're standing up here on the rim, you can barely hear the sound of this rapid.
But this rapid is in fact evidence of one of the most spectacular geological events to have ever hit the canyon.
The real star, actually, of the scene that you're looking at are those dark rocks that seem to be flowing down into the Grand Canyon. And in fact, it did flow. These are ancient lava flows that went into the canyon, a river of fire meeting a river of water. And they basically plugged the canyon up. They dammed it. These lavas came from many vents, of which we can see several. There is one across there, across the canyon, which has been eroded somewhat. And there's a whole bunch more of these cinder cones and vents throughout this region.
Like many volcanoes, cinder cones are small mountains of ash left behind by molten lava. Much of the Grand Canyon region is dotted with these lava vents, but their formation here at Tarawip is unusual. Geological fault lines crisscross the canyon and form when tectonic activity causes plates of rock to split and offset. At Tarawip, the plates of rock either side of the fault line were then stretched apart, allowing lava to escape up from the molten magma beneath the Earth's crust, leaving behind the cinder cones we see today.
500,000 to a million years ago, when these lavas were flowing into the river, it must have been an absolutely awesome sight.
The lava spewing from such volcanic eruptions would have created a dam twice the height of Glen Canyon, flooding an area three times the length of Lake Powell. Compared to any man-made dam, the impact on the ecology of the canyon must have been devastating. But over a mere few thousand years, a split second by geological standards, the Colorado River simply eroded the lava dams away.
This canyon, this river, has experienced many, many damming events in its history, from lava flows and other things. And it has overcome these obstacles many times and quite rapidly. It means that species, the ecosystem that's in the canyon, has evolved to cope with these kinds of events. So presumably the ecosystem will learn to cope with this particular dam also. And Glen Canyon Dam, from the geological perspective, from the non-human perspective, is just a mere incident, something that happens in a twinkling of an eye and is gone. But the day might come when the dam is sitting there, a huge concrete monolith, and the buttresses into which the dam is built are simply gone.
Dams made from harder stuff than concrete, dams twice as tall and twice as thick as any modern-day examples, were easily swept away by the Colorado River. The huge volume of water that had built up drained away, tearing through the canyon in a massive flood. The history of the Grand Canyon shows how the landscape reshapes and reforms, even if to us it looks like it has always been the same. At 5 million years old, the Grand Canyon is still a geological infant. It's a staggering monument to nature's raw power and beauty. One that forces us to examine our relationship with the planet as a whole. A relationship that some have understood for centuries.
The Grand Canyon holds a lot of information about the past, but it also is important for people today to recognize that. And for us to manage it and protect and preserve these areas are very important for the future of our children.
After the Grand Canyon became famous, its sheer immensity seemed to drive people to tame it. Yet the changes they made have done nothing to challenge the true grandeur of the canyon, which will remain testimony to the power of the earth, not of humans.
From Nova to Antiques Roadshow and Masterpiece Theater to the NewsHour, only TPT offers you the variety and quality of programming you love. Help support future programming by becoming a member today. Visit us at tpt.org.
This program was made possible by contributions to your PBS station from viewers
of what is now Arizona.